Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to American Reformed Church, and as always, it's always good to be here to gather as God's people to take a rest from our labor, to worship the Lord, to sing praises to God, to confess our sins, to hear the good news of the gospel, and offer ourselves to the Lord. As we gather here today, I have a few announcements, and as I do so, I invite you to please sign and pass the friendship pads. I want to welcome all of our guests and family and friends who are with us today and pray that God blesses you as well as those who are watching at home. I got an update a couple days ago. Actually, it was yesterday. Lou Cool had surgery for his gallbladder to be removed. So Lou had his gallbladder removed yesterday. He has a little pancreatitis yet, so they're going to hold him. I got another announcement here.
Excuse me, Tim. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt right in the middle of that one, but I just wanted to make sure the Truesdale family got a plate. I'm not sure if Molly got one, but it's just a reminder. Next week is our potluck.
Oh, wonderful.
Well, we're just asking everybody to bring one thing to pass, dessert, main dish, vegetables, whatever, chips, anything. We'll put it out. And we'll provide the silverware, the service, the drinks. We're just asking you to come out and join us and just have some fellowship time.
Wow, look at this plate. Can I go back for seconds, Beth?
Well, you know, I had a couple of comments about that. They were pretty small, aren't they? So, like I said, we'll provide the plate, so
wonderful.
It'll be a little bit bigger than
wonderful.
This.
Wonderful. Well, very exciting. So next week, we got a family potluck here at the church.
Yep.
After Sunday school, and we got our plates to remind us.
Absolutely. Hang them on your fridge, set them on your counter, whatever to remind you to come on out and join us.
Well, thank you, Beth. Really appreciate that. All right.
Thanks,
so everyone
Tim.
Got your plate? Let's see your plates. There it is. All right. Now, if you get a little warm today, you can go like this, right? Yeah. So, well, thank you, Beth, for a wonderful reminder. It's going to be a lot of fun next week with our family potluck and great reminder. And with this artwork, you know what I do with good artwork? We put it on our fridge. So put it on the fridge is a great reminder. So thank you, Beth. With that, I was going to continue with that. So keep Lou in your prayers. He's doing well. And so he is dealing with a little pancreatitis, but hopefully go home tomorrow from Sioux Falls. With that, I am going to be visiting Lou on this after service today because I have a couple of meetings this afternoon. And so my adult Heidelberg class, I will not be able to lead this morning. So maybe talk to me after the service and we'll see what we can come up with. But keep Lou in the prayer and Kathy as well. Also, looking at things going on next week, in addition to our potluck, Jody Ellingson from Mission E4 will be visiting us next week to talk about Mission E4. Remember with Pastor Al, he talked a lot about the ministry that they're doing in Haiti. And one of the thoughts I had is, you know, a lot of organizations are doing great work in where you can sponsor a child for like $30 a month to help them with food and learning the faith. And Mission E4 is a great organization that does a lot of work with child sponsorships and that kind of work as well. And so as she's coming next week, I want to encourage you, if you aren't already doing some sort of child sponsorship in this capacity, or if maybe God's calling you to take on another child, this will be a great opportunity for you to learn about what they're doing in Haiti for children. And opportunity for you to be directly supporting kids. I know our church, we already have a few people already supporting children through Mission E4, and so I'm excited to have Jody come and share with us what they're doing with that as well. Also, looking at what's coming up, we have the potluck, and then as we get into Holy Week, this week we have sub sandwiches, but then into Holy Week we got Journey to the Cross, which is a wonderful opportunity to reflect on what Christ did for us. For Palm Sunday, we have the Cantata. We have Monday, Thursday service, and Easter. And so it's a really exciting time of this year as we reflect upon just the hope that we continue to have in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so with that, as we gather here today for Lent, we've been reflecting on the cross of Christ. And so Laura Hawk is going to lead us as we look at the charge, King of the Jews, that was placed on the cross.
Today is the fourth Sunday of Lent. As we gather in worship, we remember the sign placed on the cross of Jesus that read, "Jesus, King of the Jews." Let us say our call to worship together, found in Matthew 27, verse 33 through 37.
They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink, mixed with gall. But after tasting it, he refused to drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed a written charge against him. This is Jesus, the King of the Jews.
Let us pray. Lord, once again, we think about the cross of Jesus Christ and what he endured for our sins, how Jesus suffered on that cross and died a horrific death because of what we have done. We think about the sign that was placed over his head to mock him as king. But even though Pilate placed Jesus upon the cross, it was our sins that put him there. Pilate was the king who ordered Jesus on the cross, but it was Jesus, the true king, who allowed it all to happen for the sake of his kingdom. It was Jesus who has the true power and authority over heaven and earth as the Son of God. Lord, we confess our sins before you today. Lord, we know that we have turned from you repeatedly and have not obeyed your commands or lived according to your spirit. We have not loved you as we should have, nor have we loved our neighbor as ourselves. But in confessing our sins, we know that the joy that will come through the resurrection of Christ, that in Jesus you have forgiven us and that we are made new in Christ. And so may we live in that hope and joy in Christ throughout all of eternity. In Christ's name we pray, amen. In the grace of Jesus Christ, let us greet one another.
Complete, I have found at his feet. guilt and despair, Jesus took on him there. And Calvary covers it all.
Our next song is Above All, and as we consider that sign that they placed on the cross in order to mock Jesus, it really was a true sign of who Jesus really is. He is the King of Kings above all. So please join us in singing.
Above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind the stone, you lived to die, rejected and wrong like a rose, trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Above all powers, above all above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind the stone, you
this time, we invite the children to come forward for this morning's children's sermon, led by Corey Wiertsma. Mm-hmm.
All right. How is everybody this morning? Good? All right. Sun's shining. It's a beautiful day. You like looking at yourselves up there, don't you? It's kind of fun. Okay. So today I have a little something I want to show you. Pastor Tim's going to be talking about mustard seed. Has anybody ever seen mustard seed? Yeah? They're kind of small. And yes, I'll clean it up if I make a mess. Okay, take a look at these. Pretty little, right? Not too big. Trust me, you don't want to eat one of these. They don't taste very good just like this. You see them? All right. Okay, can you believe that big things can come from little things? Sure. Sure you do. Come on. I'll give you an example, and I asked permission for this. Okay? Riker, can you stand up? Okay, there's Riker. You can just stand there. Is your dad a big guy? Uh-huh. Yeah. So here's proof right here. Riker's a little guy, and at one time Ross was. I remember that. And now Ross is a very tall, grown-up man. Okay, you can sit down. So we have to believe that, right? So in Matthew, Jesus talks about a parable about mustard seed. So from a seed that small, there's a picture going to come up on the thing. I want you to take a look. Can you believe that? A seed that small can turn into a tree that big. That's kind of amazing, isn't it? If you've been on a farm, you see this stuff a little bit more than maybe in town or with a garden or something like that. Sometimes we think just because we're small, we can't really do a whole lot for the kingdom of God. You ever think that sometimes? No? Good. Good. It's important. Sometimes we might think we're too old to do something important for the kingdom of God. Or maybe we're not smart enough. Or maybe we don't know the Bible well enough to really, you know, make a big difference in God's kingdom. But if you think about different things in the Bible, you can think back to the Christmas story. And maybe a little town, just a little one in Palestine, out there kind of in the middle of nowhere, Bethlehem. But something big happened in Bethlehem, didn't it? And maybe there's just a plain old little manger or feeding trough that held the Son of God in it. Pretty awesome. And then farther along, when we hear about the apostles doing things, we hear about some of the things that they did and that Jesus, when he was teaching, there were two fish and five loaves. Does anybody remember how many people that fed? Over 5,000. That was just counting the men. The kids and the women didn't even count in there, and they were all along there too. So amazing things can happen. So we have to remember that even though a mustard seed is little, if we have that much faith, we can do great things for the kingdom of God. You might think, well, you know, when you're at kids' club or at Sunday school or something like that, you know, you might push your chair underneath the table. You might pick up something that fell on the floor. Is that important? Yeah, it sure is. I know our custodians appreciate it when people pick up after themselves. And I know as a teacher, I like that when we pick up after ourselves, right? Okay, so if you tell one other person about Jesus, that could lead to a lot of people knowing about Jesus, right? So never let anybody tell you that being small isn't a big thing, because you can do very, very big things for Jesus. Okay? Let's pray. Dear Lord, we just thank you so much for the lesson of the mustard seed and how even though we might not think we're a big deal or we think we're so small we really can't do anything to help the kingdom of God, we learn that we can. And that you can do anything with us if we just ask you to use us in the way you want us to. Lord, we might have a small church, or we think it's a small church, but our church can do great things for your kingdom, as each one of us can do great things for you, Lord. Just give us the strength to do that and to show our light to other people in the world. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it costs to see
Thank you, Kylie and Brenna, and for Kylie coming to share your gifts, and Brenna as well. So thank you for sharing the wonderful message of our the hope and love we have to worship our Lord. At this time, I invite you, as we turn into God's Word, as we're going to look at the kingdom of God, we're actually going to be in Luke chapter 13. So we're in Luke 13, verses... Let me see here. Nope, we're in Matthew. Matthew 13, 31. All right. All right, Matthew chapter 13, verses 31 through 32. With that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we thank you for your holy word. We thank you for the seed of faith that you have planted in us and for the kingdom of God. And so, Lord, as we gather here to worship you today, may your word speak to us and your truth and what you have to say to us. Inspire us, Lord, by your spirit to do the work of your kingdom. Because as we'll learn what the kingdom of God is like, it's not with great power and might that you show, but it is starting with a seed of faith as small as a mustard seed and to watch it grow. And so, Lord, may we today be filled with that seed of faith and continue to nurture it and watch it grow as you call us to plant that seed in others for your kingdom. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Hear the word of the Lord beginning in verse 31. Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in his field. Though it is the smallest of all your seeds, yet when it grows, it is the largest of garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and perch in its branches. This is God's holy and inspired word. Today we ask the question, what is the kingdom of God like? What is the kingdom of heaven like? And Jesus compares his kingdom to that of a mustard seed, which starts small but grows into one of the biggest trees there is, that the trees and the birds of the air, which initially might eat upon the seed, now come to perch themselves and rest on its branches. But when I think about the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, what exactly are we talking about? What is Jesus referring to with the kingdom of God and kingdom of heaven? You know, when I think of kingdoms, I think, let's see if I work there. There we go. When I think of kingdoms, I think of geography, don't you? When you think of kingdoms, you think of ninth grade social studies, right? Where you get the map out and you look at, okay, here's the Byzantine Empire and here's the Holy Roman Empire. And you get a map out because you look at geography, right? And so when we think about kingdoms, we think about kings, and we think about spaces and geography for it, right? And so when Jesus talks about the kingdom of heaven, to be honest, it confuses me because I'm like, well, where is the kingdom of heaven on a map? How do you outline that? What does that even mean? But the reality is, when we talk about kingdoms, the word kingdom isn't so much about geography, but the word kingdom is about rule and dominion and authority. Because in the word kingdom, you have the word king, which most of us understand what kings are. But then you get the familiar part of it, the dom, the D-O-M, where we get our words like dominate or domineering or dominion, or for the old-time Dutch folk, dominie, right? Yeah, some of you remember that word, right? What does dominie mean? It means lord, to lord over, to rule. And so when we're talking about kingdoms, when we think about kingdoms of this world, and we think about Jesus as the king, we're not talking about physical geography. We're talking about the things that rule or control us, control our lives and rule over us, have dominion. And so when Jesus talks about kingdoms, and when we think about kingdoms, let's not think about maps, but we think about what is it that rules over our lives. And so the question for us is, what is the kingdom? What rules, or who or what rules over our life? And as we see in Scripture and we see in our life, we see many different kingdoms, good kings and bad kings. We see kings that oppress and kingdoms that are oppressive and persecute its own people. And we see wonderful kingdoms. And certainly as we look at Scripture, Jesus is the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, who gives life. And so if there is a kingdom that I would ever want to be part of, if there was ever a ruler that I want to rule over me, it would be Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who came to bring life and life eternal in him. And so today we're going to think about, okay, Christ's kingdom, and how in this world, literally, how in the world can the kingdom of heaven make an impact in my life today? Because the reality is there's lots of rulers and authorities. There's a lots of principalities in this world. There's a lot of people and politicians and economic factors. There's a lot of factors in our life that are lording over us. And so how in the world can Jesus Christ overcome all of these things that we deal with today? Every Sunday, I want to begin with this. Every Sunday, as we gather as God's people, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, the Lord's Prayer, right? And what do we pray in this Lord's Prayer? Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And so what does that mean as we pray it every day? It means that we are asking for God to bring his kingdom on earth. In other words, we are praying that heaven reign on earth. Because when we know and what we know about heaven, we know that is a place of perfection. It is a place of joy and eternal happiness where there's no more crying or pain, and that the love of God is there in reconciliation through Jesus Christ, that we eternally live in heaven in the presence of God. And so when we think about the joy of heaven and the delight of heaven in the presence of God, we are praying to God that the joy of heaven be here on earth, that as we live our time in earth in faith in Jesus Christ, that our world, that our community, that our lives, our families, that everything around us be as it is in heaven, where there is no more violence, there's no more fear, no more worries, no more death or disease, no more struggles or anger, but pure joy in the presence of the Lord. And so we pray for God's kingdom, for that our time here on earth to be as it is in heaven. And so we pray for Worthington and Reading and Brewster and Bigelow and Harris and Lake Park and Round Lake and Sibley and Adrian and all the other towns I probably forgot to mention. We pray that our world and our communities can be the presence of God's kingdom, that God's kingdom can rule as it is in heaven. But there's one problem that we all face in this, and you're all well aware of it, that the kingdom of this world is powerful, and it doesn't want to give up its force easily, does it? The prince of this earth, the power of the air, there's a spirit of darkness in this air that came over to the world, and we face it, we breathe it in, we sense it. We feel the oppression, we feel the powers that are taking place in this world, and that they come against us. And when we try to go up against this, when we try to share the light of Christ, when we try to live according to the word of God or share the gospel, you can feel it, can't you? You can feel the powers that are in this world. And that oftentimes we get discouraged. We get frustrated because we so much want to be joy. We so much want Christ and the power of God in our lives and in the lives of others. Yet, we face so much struggles with us. Psalm 2, verse 2 tells us that the kings of this earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together. They meet together. They take counsel against the Lord and against his anointed. In other words, there's a deck stacked against us as we try to bring forth God's kingdom, the joy of heaven here on earth. Because let's face it, there's a lot of things that we get frustrated and angry about. Decisions that are being made, economic forces, you know, relationships, our medical issues, our emotional, mental place. And we cry out to God as the Psalms say, "Why, O Lord, how long will this be?" But the reality of the situation as we think about the kingdom of this world, the spirit of darkness, the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, as God's word says, we see how Jesus was faced with that same physical and spiritual oppression. Jesus, as he proclaimed the kingdom of God as the Son of God, if you think anyone would believe anyone and anyone would follow the kingdom of God, you think that Jesus, the Son of God himself, everyone would be flocking to him and following him. But that was not the case. Jesus in his hometown, they were skeptical of him. One of his disciples says, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And the scripture says Jesus couldn't do miracles near his hometown. Why? Because the prophet is without honor in his hometown. They kept saying, "Isn't this Joseph's son?" So even Jesus' own people were skeptical of him. His followers, as he's teaching and preaching about the kingdom of God, they only wanted to see his signs and miracles. But when Jesus started teaching and preaching about who he was, they found his teaching to be too hard for them. What about the Pharisees, right? The religious political group who are trying to bring the independence of Israel at the time, who are trying to get back to the Bible and God's word to get freedom from Rome. The Pharisees who hold all the strings in Jerusalem, the capital city, they didn't believe that he was the Christ. Jesus kept telling them, "I am the anointed, I am the Son of God." And they still did not believe him. In fact, they were afraid of him because they thought because Jesus was saying these things that they too would suffer because they didn't believe that Jesus could do what he came to do. And last, we see the power of Rome, the Roman governments. I mean, we've all studied about the Roman Empire. They're still making movies about the Roman Empire. And here, Jesus, born to a son of a carpenter as the Son of God, and you have the power of the Roman Empire, Caesar Augustus, Pontius Pilate, the governor of Judea, who had power over him. And we see that power that the world had over Jesus. Because in John 19:11, Pilate said to Jesus, "You will not speak to me?" And here's what Pilate says to Jesus. "Do you not know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you?" That is what the world said to Jesus. That is what Pilate said to Jesus. That is what Jesus was facing in the kingdom of this world. "Don't you know I'm the one who has the power and authority whether or not to crucify you?" But of course, Jesus knew that the authority wasn't in Pilate, but Jesus willingly laid down his life. And so when we think about trying to bring God's kingdom into this world, trying to bring the joy of heaven into this world and reconciliation in Christ, just as Jesus faced those same obstacles and oppression, so we too face the powers and principalities of this world. And perhaps we feel angry or frustrated at times by what is happening in this world as well. As we look at our war is not against physical principles, but it's a spiritual battle. So if that's the case, if we're talking about bringing the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, which is not about physical geography, it's about rule and dominion, and every time we try to say something about God, and we see this on the news and the media and all over this place, we see resistance when we try to bring the gospel into the world. And perhaps we feel it in our life. So the question we have for us today then is, how could Jesus possibly overcome the world and bring in the reign of God's kingdom? I mean, if the reality is there's powerful kings and rulers in this world, how in the world could Jesus possibly overcome it? How could Jesus fare up against a holy Roman Empire and all the centurions and all the forces? How could Jesus go against Caesar Augustus or Pontius Pilate? Even the Pharisees, he couldn't even get his own people to believe what he could do when he proclaimed he was the Son of God, the Christ. Even the high priest at his time who ruled over the temple said this about Jesus. He says, better for one man to die, meaning on the cross, better for us to turn him over to the cross than a whole nation to die. Even the high priest didn't believe who Jesus was, and they sold him out. Even one of Jesus' own disciples, Judas, sold him out because Jesus wasn't doing what he wanted, didn't believe that Jesus could do what he would do. And to be honest, at times, I think we sometimes might feel the same. Sometimes we sell out on Jesus. We give up on faith. We give up on God and what God can do. Because how could God possibly rescue us from our situations? How could God rescue us from our illness, from our sin, from our frustrations, and our sense of hopelessness? And so there are times where sometimes the world just, we feel like the world is just too strong for us to fight. So how in the world could Jesus overcome the world and bring in the reign of God's kingdom? Jesus did so on the cross. Jesus did so on the cross. Jesus disarmed the powers and principalities because the most that they could do was to put him on the cross and crucify him. But yet, Jesus shown on the cross that it was on the cross that he showed that these powers and principalities that this world flaunts in our face all the time had no power or over control over him. Because what could the world do to him that God could not do in raising him from the dead? And Jesus compares himself to a seed that needs to be planted in order to bear fruit. For Jesus says in John 12, truly, truly, I say to you, that unless a grain of wheat falls to the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Let me say this again, what Jesus teaches us. He tells his disciples, unless a grain of wheat falls to the earth and dies, it remains alone. It's just a seed. It does nothing. But when it dies, if we bury it into the ground, what happens? It bears much fruit. And so what Jesus willingly said and said about himself is that Jesus willingly allowed himself to die on the cross, to be buried into the grave, to be buried into the ground. Why? So that God could resurrect him from the grave to show that death nor sin has power over him. For Jesus allowed this to happen, that he could be buried and planted in order that he be raised and bear much fruit. And that was God's plan all along, to show that Jesus Christ in the kingdom of God has power over sin and death and the principalities of this world. Because if Jesus can conquer death, then nothing in this world can conquer Christ, because Christ came into the world and loved the world, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And so in Jesus and his kingdom, that seed of faith is planted in us as well. The seed of faith of Jesus Christ, that all it takes is a little faith, the size of a mustard seed, to be trust in God, that we would be willing to be buried in Christ, to bury our own selves, our own agendas, our own whatever we're trying to hang on to in this world. Because if we put in faith in Christ, then what can the world do to us? And we put our faith in Christ in order that we may be raised in Christ in faith. That, my brothers and sisters, is the kingdom of God and the power of the kingdom of God. That there is nothing that this world can do to us that can overcome the seed of faith that is planted in us in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. No person, no principalities, no illness or sickness, no whatever you want to name it, no power of this world is greater than the power of Jesus Christ. And he proved it on the cross. And so when we think about the kingdom of God, when we think about how to make an impact of God's kingdom in this world, how do we make an impact in Worthington as our church is located here in this community? How do we start to see the movement of seed of faith in believers? How do we see the movement of God in our own lives and whatever we're faced? Well, Jesus teaches us it starts with a seed of faith. It starts with a small seed of faith in believers. It doesn't take a whole lot. Jesus isn't asking for a big tree right away. He just is asking you and I to put a little faith in him. That when things do get tough, that we don't abandon him, but rather hold on to that little faith of hope and love that we have. And when it starts in the small seed of faith in believers, we are called to watch it nurture and to watch it grow, to see that little seed of faith in us. We might not know the Bible well, as Corey mentioned in the children's message. We might have a lot of doubts and a lot of anxieties, a lot of anger and frustrations by the things that go on. But the kingdom of God starts with a small seed of faith. And so I'm asking you today to put a little faith in God, to maintain that little faith in God, and to nurture it and watch it grow. And in my experience, as I've seen, when we put a little faith in God and watch it grow, we see God take over that seed and make it grow. And we'll see God take over a church, a community, and what Christ was called to take over the world. And so, church, as we think about God's word today and the seed of faith, I want us to think about what it would look like for the kingdom of God to be here on earth as it is in heaven. What would it be like for our community and our homes and in our county, in our state? What would it be like if we truly were longing for and saw and pray that the kingdom of God will be on earth as it is in heaven? What would that look like? Admittedly, we are faced with major forces in this world. And perhaps, like myself, sometimes we give into those forces and believe that they are too strong and too powerful. But as we see with Jesus Christ, all it does is start with a small seed of faith in Christ. Only needs to be as small as a mustard seed. You don't have to change the world today, but just put a little faith in Christ for tomorrow and nurture that faith and watch it grow. And then, as God is growing in us, in the joy of, as we see the branches being put out and the fruit being bared, what happens with the tree once it grows? It produces its own seeds, doesn't it, right? And so as we start with that seed of faith in Christ and watch that grow in us, then naturally we'll see how God is using us to plant seed of faith in others as well. I don't need to change someone today. I don't need to lecture them or scold them for tomorrow. But just plant that little seed of faith and hope in them through Jesus Christ. That God is in control over all things and all circumstances. And to nurture some other people as well. As we plant those seeds in others, nurture them, encourage them, pray with them, whatever it is that they need, that they can grow in their faith as well. And in doing this, we keep doing this until we'll see the fruit of God all around us through the seed of faith in Jesus Christ. And so when we think about the kingdom of God, Jesus was put on the cross because they expected Jesus to take the world by storm. They wanted Jesus to claim the borders of his nation. They wanted him to have this war against Rome and to lead this uprising. And as you read in Acts, in the history of the world, you see how there were many people, and there continues to be people in this world who rise up and start revolutions, or they start rebellions and they start wars and all this stuff. It happens all the time in this world. But the reality is, kingdoms of this world come and fall. And I've said this many times before, as great as Rome is, there is no Roman Empire anymore. As great as Caesar was, his kingdom fell. But God's kingdom is still here. We're still proclaiming the kingdom of God, the kingdom of Jesus Christ. Why? Because he is the Son of God. And so if you're going to look at what king, what rule, what kingdom to follow, today I say put your hope and faith in Jesus Christ. All it takes is a little faith and trust him. I know it's scary. The cross is scary. We don't want to do the cross. I'd rather be the one with the sword, like Pilate, when he ignorantly thought he was the one in control. We want to be in control. We want to be like Pilate. I'd rather be Pilate than Jesus on the cross, right? But Jesus showed that he is the one with the true power. And so today, as we think about kingdoms and power and what rules your life, if you're thinking about where can I find hope? Where can I find security? Where can I find comforts and fortitude and security in who I am and where I'm going and what God is doing? It's not found in Caesar Augustus. It's not found in the kingdoms of this world because they come and fall. Organizations come and fall as well. Strong businesses in the 1900s that were huge now are closing shops and no one's heard of them. But centuries later, even in the 2019th year of our Lord, we're still proclaiming the kingdom of God and his reign. And so church today, let us not be overwhelmed by all that is with us, but let us start with a seed of faith. Seed of faith today, a seed of faith tomorrow, and just each day faithfully follow our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, because there is a kingdom in heaven that awaits for us. And these past few weeks we've celebrated and said goodbye to loved ones of our church as they've gone to be in that kingdom. But we know and have our hope in the kingdom that will last forever. Let us pray. Gracious and Heavenly Father, today I thank you for your kingdom, because there are powerful and evil forces in this world. Satan continues to trick us and to fool us into thinking that we need to put our faith in tangible things and the powers of this world. But Lord, there is only one kingdom that matters. There's only one kingdom that rules over our lives. And that no matter what, whoever is in power, Lord, you put all governments in power, all nations together. But there is only one kingdom that rules over us, and that is in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And Lord, we acknowledge and we thank you that Jesus Christ showed us the power, because anyone can kill someone because of sin, but only God can raise them from the dead. It's easy to bear a sword, but you call us to lay down our lives for you. And because of that, your kingdom is more powerful than all kingdoms because of the resurrection of Christ. And so, Lord, may we put our faith today in Christ and his kingdom and his rule in our life. That wherever we go, maybe we move from here, maybe jobs take us elsewhere, maybe we graduate and go to different places, different nations, different states or cities, that wherever we go, we are part of your kingdom. And so, Lord, today I just want to pray for our church. Give us that seed of faith to put our faith, hope, and trust in you. And Lord, as we grow in you, may the fruits of joy, the fruit of the Spirit that your word speaks of, just continue to grow and bear fruit, that it can fall to the ground and that we can plant seeds of faith in others. And so, Lord, give us that faith to nurture and watch it grow in others as well. And so, God, we thank you for all the blessings we have, that you are a God of history, that your word isn't just simply philosophical ideas or pragmatic applications, but you are a God of history who has power over all things. And we thank you for that. And so we turn to you, Lord, through your grace alone. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. At this time, we're going to take our morning offering as we sing our hymn.
Thank you.
As we hear God's word now, let us offer prayers for the church and for the world in the light of Christ and his kingdom. Let us pray. Gracious and holy Father, we thank you for your kingdom and the grace alone that was given to us on the cross of Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray now that as we put our faith as small as a mustard seed in you, that our gifts to you may be pleasing and acceptable in our sight, that we can offer our lives in service to you and to others, Lord, in the grace of Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for your church here at American Reformed, for your church in our communities and your church throughout the world. We thank you for the body of Christ that we can fellowship as believers and to encourage one another through your holy word and through prayer. God, I thank you for our guests who are with us today and those who are watching home. And we just pray the blessing of Jesus Christ upon them as well, as you have blessed us here today. Lord, we continue to pray for the ministries of our church. God, I thank you for all the activities that are going on. But Lord, as we get into all these activities, Lord, we just pray that we can keep you at the forefront, that we don't get overburdened by all the changing of the season, but to continue to look at the power of the cross of Christ. Lord, I thank you for all of our Sunday school teachers and, Lord, and the students, and I pray that they continue to be blessed as they dig into the word and the doctrines of the church. Lord, I thank you for the other ministry groups that are meeting this week as well. And Lord, I thank you for all the blessings you give us in ministry, both at home and in our community and within the church, for all the things that are seen and the things unseen. Lord, today we want to be in prayer for our congregation, Lord. We are grateful that Helen Brands and Ken Zylstra can be here today. Lord, we just pray for continuing recovering for Helen as she's recovering from her hip replacement surgery. And we pray that you continue to be with Ken Zylstra, and we're grateful for his faith as he continues his journey with ALS. Lord, I want to lift up in prayer Ken Van Veldhuizen as he battles with pancreatic cancer. And Lord, just Janine Decker as well, as she's also battling with her cancer. Lord, be with them. Strengthen them to know that the power of Christ, the power of your kingdom, your eternal kingdom in store for us in heaven, where our citizenship lies. And so, Lord, that I just pray that you uphold them in your care, in your hands, and may the light of Christ continue to inspire and hope, give hope for them as well. Lord, I want to lift in prayer Lou Kuhl, who is recovering from his gallbladder being removed yesterday. I pray for Lou and Kathy, Lord, as they've been through a lot these past few weeks. But Lord, sustain them and be with them and know that the presence of Christ, that you promised to be with us always, even to the end of this age, that even though you have ascended to the right hand of God in heaven, that your spirit is upon us and has been given to us to know that we are yours and belong to you and to your kingdom. And so, Lord, I thank you for for our church, and I just lift up all the needs of our congregation, all the prayer concerns that are said or unsaid. And, Lord, we just continue to put our faith in you, to put our trust in you alone by your grace. Lord, I thank you for the missions and ministries of our church. And, Lord, we just want to continue to pray for all of our missionaries that we are being sent throughout the world. And God, we are grateful that Mission E4 will be able to be with us next week. And Lord, just open our hearts and our minds to what you are doing in this world. And even to put faith as to trust in you if you are calling us to also support these missions and ministries in new and unique ways. And so God, I thank you for all the blessings you've given us for this day. And Lord, I just pray as we go forth from here that we can put our trust in you into all things. As we pray the prayer Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, let us stand and sing our closing hymn, Wherever He Leads, I Will Go.
Take up thy cross and follow me.
And now may the kingdom of Christ rule in you this week as we follow where Christ leads us. In Christ's holy name we pray, amen.